Do you think we can do that together?
Good morning.
Good morning, SEMC family.
Good morning. Good morning.
Wonderful. Look at that. Good. Oh, Teddy, thank you. Well, welcome to the SEMC. Thank you for taking some time out of your week to join us here as we unify our hearts together in worship of our risen Lord. Let me just invite you to stand with me as we read our call to worship this morning from Psalm 91, and then the music team here is going to lead us in some songs of worship. So will you stand with me? Psalm 91 says this: "He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrows that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday. Because he holds fast to me in love, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name. When he calls to me, I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation." Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you that this morning we can be in your house worshiping you as the body of Christ. And thank you, Lord, that you have called us your church, that you have brought us together for a purpose and with a plan. And so this morning, as we worship you, Lord, would you encourage our hearts, Lord, to know and trust in the risen Savior. And Father, just prepare our hearts today as we hear from your word, sing of your truth, Lord, and go into the world and live out the great commission that Jesus calls us to. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Bring joy to the city of thank you for that. Sounding good this morning. The next song we're going to do is an old one. And by old, I mean the 1700s. Anybody here then? Anyone? No? Okay. sometimes it feels like it, right? but this is a really one of the great hymns of our Christian faith. And I just wanted to share just a tiny little bit about what brought that song about. And the song's called "O For a Thousand Tongues." And I can't imagine what having a thousand tongues would be like, but when Charles Wesley was thinking about writing this song, he thought back to some people that he met, and he was on a ship. They were traveling, and he ran into some Christian people. And one of the leaders' names was Peter Bowler. And he was a man that Charles Wesley really admired for his deep faith. And that man, Mr. Bowler, said to him, "Oh, Brother Wesley, the Lord has done so much for my life. Had I a thousand tongues, I would praise Christ Jesus with every one of them." And that's what brought about Charles Wesley writing this great hymn. And we're going to sing it together, and it's related to Psalm 35, verse 28. "Then my tongue shall tell of your righteousness and of your praise all the day long." So even though it's an oldie, and sometimes those are a little harder to sing, I just hope that you can hear the words today and sing them as though you were praising the Lord even that much more. You can have a seat for right now.
Hey, how are you? I missed you. Hey, thanks, thanks everybody. My name is Dave. For those of you who don't know me or don't remember I'm employed here, and but very thankful for your prayer and encouragement. As Amanda and I had the opportunity to have a couple of weeks away on vacation. Vacation, such a sweet word. Seems like so long ago. So here's what I want to do, because a lot of people are asking, did you have a good time? Are you know, all those kinds of things. So the answer is yes. So if you want to ask me, the answer is yes. But I don't know what you've been up to for 2 weeks. So think of something good, and on the count of three, I want you to share something good that's happened for you in these last 2 weeks. Sound good? All right, ready? One, two, three. Sleep. No, you got to try it again. Try it again. No. It's three. Yeah, three. Ready? And you got to do it with enthusiasm, because it's good. It's something that's exciting for you, right? Ready? One, two, three.
Sleep.
Oh, that is so good. I cannot wait to talk further about that with you. And thank you so much for sharing that. Appreciate the opportunity that you have had to have some goodness shared in your life as well. So together with Amanda this morning is Sandra singing here and Heather singing there and Jerry in the drums on the back, in the back. Are you still back there? Yep, you are.
Oh, yeah.
And And over here is Steve Bird, and Steve may be new to some of you, and so we are thankful for Steve just being part of our team, and he's been practicing with our team. He has fans out there, and so he's been practicing with our teams over the course of the last few months. He has got a nice, humble spirit, a desire to be part of what God is doing with us as a church family, and we are thankful for his gifts as part of our music team. So let's show our appreciation to a team as well. So those are good things, right? Those are really good things. I'm excited about those kinds of things for sure. And very thankful for President John Cressman, president of our denomination, for being here a couple of weeks ago. Anybody remember what he spoke about? Spoke about God. Thank you, Sunday school people, for being in church your whole lives. And excellent. Our good friend Joel Zanting was here last week. Anybody remember what he spoke about? God also. Yeah, I'll save that. Yeah. So take a listen. If you didn't get a chance or you don't remember, I know sometimes it's hard once you leave here and the week goes on, but very good messages. One right about understanding our personal story and how God can give God control of our personal story, and the other about welcoming those who are different than us, and that is God's mandate for us. And so those two messages actually go together, fit beautifully with who we are as a church family, and I appreciate both of those people for coming. Hey, and just a little note here, I just met this morning Dan Bennett, and Dan, I don't know your wife's name. Mary Beth. So Dan is a former pastor at the SEMC from 1980. So we put in the orange carpet back for him because we heard he was coming, and resonated well with that. So it's the exact same carpet, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Yeah. It still looks the exact same quality, doesn't it?
Yes,
yes it does. Yeah, that's so disheartening to hear, for sure. Anyway, thank you. It's good to have you here. Appreciate you coming. And did you sit in that area when you were here? Right. You're up here. Yeah. That's true. That is true. Excellent. Well, welcome. I just want to bring you a couple of announcements. One is during the month of September, our benevolence focus is on our El Salvador mission team. And we have the unique privilege of, or I guess a revisited privilege of going back in country to El Salvador in January of 2023. There are 14 people on that trip, and including I think five people who are going for the very first time, and two high schoolers. One, Ashlyn, is not in high school anymore, but she is just turned 18, right? Is that right? She just turned 18, which is hard to believe. So Ashlyn and her dad are new, and then Lily O'Dolphy and Abigail DaCosta are also the two grade 9 students who will be going with us, and then a number of others. So if you work it all out, we have people in their teens, 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, right, Pat? Yeah, that's exciting, right? That's a great reflection of who we are as a church family, to be able to serve together in the name of Jesus in this community. And so we are asking you, instead of having them go and solicit donations to you, we're asking for you to be proactive in providing a home for families in need in El Salvador. And so you can do that by submitting either by check or by e-transfer a donation. Just mark El Salvador in the comments section or the memo section, and all that will go towards a family who will receive a home in January. And so we go as ambassadors, as representatives of the SEMC when we go, and we go ambassadors as representatives of Jesus Christ. And that's a great privilege for us as well. So you may have heard last week that our youth ministry started, Impact got started on Friday night. And so for those of you who might be walking through the halls, my apologies in advance if you come across playing cards and Nerf darts or Skittles. There was a lot of things flying through the air and a lot of children running everywhere on Friday night. We had a wonderful time and look forward to, would you be praying for our students as we begin to meet our junior high and senior high students as we begin to meet in earnest every week on Friday evenings? That would be appreciated. Well, I think, and then upward, I think there was a great announcement last week, right? And everybody, I think Teresa spoke, and then Micah and Ava and Elia, and then Albert did not speak. But he got a haircut, and so that was really good. And so we're thankful that he got the opportunity to show his haircut off to everybody. And but Upward, we're excited about Upward. It'll have been 3 years by the time we get to go again. That is incredible. And we have people going crazy trying to make sure that they get their students in at Upward. And so that's something to be praying about. You can share the Upward announcement, the registration announcement. But more importantly, can you be praying about how you will be involved? God's going to entrust kids and families to us, and he's going to bring them right here. Sometimes sometimes there's over 400 people come here on a Saturday, and they get to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so you can be part of something like that. And how will you be a part? That's something to be praying about even now, to be able to do that. That's exciting, right? Well, just before I send the kids off to Kid Jam, it's my privilege to introduce today's guest speaker. We've been doing that the last couple weeks. Jerry's been introducing the guest speaker in this time slot. So today's guest speaker has saved us a lot of money in mileage costs, and we are very thankful for that. So he comes to us. He's been married to Brenna for eight years. Yeah, you had another one. There's one coming up. It just happened. I was there. Yeah. 8 years. It was 7 years before my vacation, right? That's okay. Thank you. So now it's 8 years. They've been married for 8 years. They have three wonderful children. And they also have a growing desire to serve the Lord in ministry. And God's given Patrick a gift and a desire to communicate God's truth, and it's our privilege to be able to participate in that. And isn't it exciting for us to be able to watch and build into this development, not only for in his life but in the life of our church? And that should be exciting for others as we watch around that. So Patrick Turvey will be our guest speaker this morning. And so let's we can preempt that, right? Let's welcome Pat Turvey as he brings the word this morning. All right. So I think also a really cool thing that's happening right now is there's a transition taking place in our Kid Jam ministry, and Teresa Siertzma and Michaela Kita, they are swapping places over these next couple of weeks, have been and will be, and we're very thankful for that, right? How's it going? Going good? Yeah, awesome. So with that, are you staying in, or am I sending them with her? You're going to go down too. All right. So with Michaela Kita, our kids age 2 to grade 6, and Mrs. Siertzma, you guys can make your way down. And parents, just a reminder to sign your kids in and sign them back out before they at the end of the service. That's what I mean to say. And then just as they're headed out, let me just read these words from Psalm 146, and then we're going to sing a couple more songs. Praise the Lord, my soul. I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. Do not put your trust in princes and human beings you cannot save, who put their, when their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. Blessed are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God. He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. He remains faithful forever. He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets prisoners free. The Lord gives sight to the blind. He lifts up those who are bowed down, and he loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow, but he frustrates the way of the wicked. The Lord reigns forever, your God, O Zion, for all generations. Praise the Lord. And so, Father, as we come, as we gather together, as we center ourselves on you, we are so thankful for the kingship of Jesus. Thank you that he rules over all. Thank you for his love greater than our capacity to even understand it. Even as we translate it into song and try to communicate it by words, Father, your love is greater than any of that. And God, the things that we come up against, they can seem formidable. They can seem almost impossible to overcome. They can grab hold of us. They can distract us. And yet, God, your promise is that you will reign over that. You are supreme. And so, Father, in the darkness, may your light prevail. Where there is weakness, will you provide strength? Where there is discouragement, God, would you bring your Spirit's encouragement? Where there is need, Father, would you meet that according to the riches that you have in Christ Jesus? Father, hear our prayer. Anchor us in your truth. May it be lived out among us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to continue singing together, and if you're able, I'll ask you to stand and join us.
He is my joy.
so much. Please have a seat.
Well, good morning, everybody, again. So we're going to be turning to God's Word here in just a second. So if you have your Bibles or Bible apps with you, let me invite you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We're going to be in verses 1 to 5 today. And just before we start, I just wanted to take a minute just to really express my gratitude to this church. My wife has been coming to this church. She grew up in this church. She went to youth in this church. And so it's easy to remember how long I've been going here for, because when I moved to Sarnia and Brennan and I got married, this church became my home too. And over the past 8 years, it's been a privilege to just be a member of this church and to serve alongside each of you. So on behalf of myself and our family, we are just so grateful for the love and support that you give us regularly, and we love you and appreciate you, so thank you. This morning, we are going to be talking about the power of God. And for myself personally, when John was here a couple of weeks ago and Joel was here last week, for me, what I took away from that was just specifically in John, the power of God displayed in his life and his willingness to humble himself and listen for God and the direction that he had for him. And then Joel last week took us through the book of Acts when God calls Peter to go to the Gentiles. What I have made clean, don't call unclean. And so again, that is an example of the power of God displayed in and through his people. And so we're going to continue on in that a little bit this morning as we open up 1 Corinthians chapter 2. So let's turn there together. First Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. And I, this is the Apostle Paul speaking, when I came to you, brothers and sisters, did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom. For I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling. And my speech and my message were not plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might not rest in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Let's pray together. Holy Spirit, we pray this morning that as we open the very words of Jesus, the very words of our Lord, that you would guide us and direct us. Help us to experience God's love and power together in this place. This in Christ's name we pray. Amen. So just a bit of background. So this letter was written by the Apostle Paul to the Corinthian church, which was composed of both Jews and Gentiles. And the book of Acts tells us a couple unique points about Paul's time in Corinth. Firstly, Paul spent roughly 18 months during his second missionary journey and came to this city shortly after spending some time preaching in Athens, Greece. Second, when Paul first arrived, he would go to the Jewish synagogues each Sabbath and share the truth about Jesus. Eventually, over time, Jewish opposition rose up against Paul, and he began to shift his focus from preaching to the Jews to the Gentiles. And finally, Paul spent a year and a half in Corinth, and his mission was incredibly fruitful. People were being saved, and the church in Corinth was born. The passage that we read today comes from the first of two documented letters that we have from the Apostle Paul to the Corinthian church. And both letters that Paul wrote to the church addressed many of the diverse issues that arose within the church. Corinth was a city in biblical times that was filled with hundreds of thousands of people. Some scholars approximate somewhere in the ballpark of 400,000 people. It was one of the most prominent cities in its day. And the city had three harbors strategically located along prominent trade routes. It was a huge place of commercial trade, and merchants from all over the world would come to the city to take part in both business and pleasure. And because this city was so well cultured, Corinth was riddled in division, materialism, idolatry, and immorality. And we can see that when we read this letter. Culture was pressing in on the church, and many secular practices and worldviews were bleeding into church culture. But the gospel still cut through those contending viewpoints that Corinth offered. The fruit of Paul's labor was evident in the transformed lives of the people of the Corinthian church. Paul's letter that we are examining today is not one of initial instruction. He's not writing to them, connecting with them for the first time, but a reminder and correction for how the church was living in the midst of the existing cultural influences that they were facing. And the passage that we are examining today specifically recalls the character that Paul demonstrated when he was called by the Lord to visit Corinth on his missionary journey. In Paul's character, we're going to see that he is humble. He humbled himself in the presence of God so that God would be exalted in his life and ministry. We see Paul being willing to submit himself to the will of God and be willing to go where opposition was almost certain. And finally, we see Paul's trust in God. He trusted in the power of God through the resurrected Christ and the help of the Holy Spirit. So first, let's explore how Paul displays humility in this passage. Now, just before I do, I just want to make a really quick point. We are going to talk about Paul this morning, in case you hadn't guessed that yet. But we are also going to talk about Saul this morning. Two names, same person. Saul and Paul are actually the same name, but Saul is the Hebrew version of the name, and Paul is the Roman version of the name. Paul was Saul, and Saul was Paul. Paul was Saul before Paul, and Saul was Paul after Saul. Did you follow that? There might be a Dr. Seuss book in there somewhere. So as I said, Saul is his Hebrew name, and Paul is his Roman name. Saul became Paul shortly after his conversion, which we will talk about here in a little bit. Now, before Paul's conversion on the road to Damascus, back when he was known as Saul, he was a Jewish Pharisee who was a great persecutor of Christians. Specifically from Scripture, we know that he approved of the execution of Stephen, who was the first martyr of the church, and ravaged the church at large thereafter, throwing believers in numerous numbers into prison. But Paul wasn't a thug, as you might think. He was incredibly well-educated in the Word of God, and he had spent his entire life observing God's laws. He just hadn't yet experienced the power of God. Sure, he had trained extensively in the Mosaic Law and received classical Roman education from Tarsus, which was where he was from. He was able to argue his point from both a position of Jewish law, but also from Greek literature, often quoting sayings that were found within Greek culture in his letters. If anyone was qualified to have a long-standing debate and use their cunning speech and rhetoric to argue their position and disprove others' positions, Paul was the one. He could have done so from a moral position, he could have done so from a historical position, or even a cultural position. But once he came to know Christ and experienced the grace that comes through him alone, he recognized that ultimately it is the power of God that changes lives, not our ability to be convincing. And through his perspective, through this perspective, Paul states that he has come to the people of Corinth with none of this lofty speech and wisdom that Corinth valued so highly. He did not add verbiage to his dialogue for the sake of puffing himself up or making himself sound smart. Rather, he decided to know nothing among the Corinthian people except for Jesus Christ and him crucified. Paul experienced the life-transforming power of God in his life, in and through his conversion, and he learned that there is nothing more that he could add to what Christ had already done. Paul chose to humble himself so that Jesus would be exalted. He decreased so that Jesus could increase. And we read about that a little bit in the Acts account of when Paul actually goes to the church at Corinth. Acts chapter 18, verses 9 to 10 says this: "And the Lord said to Paul one night in a vision," this is after Paul had been called to go to the Gentiles, after he had received lots of opposition in the synagogues from the Jewish people, he's now converted his attention to the Gentiles, and the Lord comes to him one night in a vision and says this: Do not be afraid, but go on speaking, and do not be silent, for I am with you, and no one will attack you or harm you, for I have many in this city who are my people." Now, maybe you've heard this before, but when you see the word "for" in Scripture, it is meant to connect the previous thought to the next thought. God called Paul to preach and to share the gospel with the people of Corinth. He told Paul that he will be with Paul and protect him. Why? Because God still had people in that city that were his people. God was not only providing Paul with the power and faith to do the difficult work that was sharing the gospel with the Corinthians, but he was already preparing an opportunity for those in Corinth to be saved. God had prepared a way. Now he just needed Paul to step into what he had laid out for him. And God promised Paul that he would be with him. Think about when Jesus calls us in the Great Commission in Matthew 28 to go into the world. He isn't telling us to go to the world timidly and reserved, just being careful about who we talk to and interact with, but rather to go into the world, make disciples, baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Why? Because God still has people that need to hear the gospel message. In this world, in this country, in this city, in our neighborhoods, in our relationships, people that God knows but do not yet know him. And here's the best part. Remember in the Great Commission, Jesus promises that he will be with us right up until he returns. Jesus is with us in all that we do, and more than that, is continuously working through us. And when we humble ourselves and submit to his will, his power is displayed through us. I'm getting pumped up. We're not even at the application portion yet. God was with Paul as he went to the Corinthians. He just needed Paul to have a humble heart and trust in the power of God. And that's what Paul did. Paul humbled himself so that God would be exalted in and through him. But as we read from this passage, it wasn't easy. It was actually quite challenging. But Paul was willing. And that's the second characteristic of Paul that we can learn from this morning. Paul's willingness. Now, Paul writes here that when he came to preach the gospel to the Corinthians, he came to them in weakness, in fear, and in trembling. So much so that Scripture tells us that his words were not plausible words of wisdom. Now, Paul wasn't unfamiliar with sharing the gospel to unchurched communities. In fact, based on Scripture, we can put together three separate documented missionary journeys that he took. He was an experienced and effective evangelist, preaching to many different cities and many different peoples. But this passage gives us a bit of insight into Paul's heart, what he was feeling during his time at Corinth. Paul says that he came to them in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling. Yet because of God's promise to be with him that we just read in the book of Acts, he submitted to God's will. And this display of God's strength through weakness is a reoccurring theme in Paul's letters. And in fact, throughout all of Scripture. We actually learn in Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, in chapter 12, that there is some sort of thorn that hinders Paul. We don't know if this thorn, this annoyance, this hindrance is physical or mental or spiritual. We actually know very little about it, but it doesn't actually matter what it is. What we know is that reading from Scripture, that it hindered Paul in some way. And he actually pleaded with the Lord three times to remove it. And we read about that a little bit in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Paul says, "Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness.' Therefore," Paul says, "I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ on me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, I am strong." Paul continuously reminds us again and again that God's power is seen in greatest display through our weakness. When we are weak, when we are humble, God is strong. When we are persecuted, God helps us to persevere. When we have anxieties and worries, God gives us hope. For when we are weak, we are strong in Christ. This thorn in Paul's life was there to serve as a reminder to him of God's power in his life. And for Christ's sake, Paul was content to deal with various hardships and opposition. But people have a choice. God doesn't drag people along unwillingly against their will. Paul could have said no. But Paul had experienced the power of God. Paul even admits that to him, his speech and message were not coherent, well put together. Rather, he appeared weak and came to the Corinthians with fear and trembling. This was to further demonstrate that it is the power of the Holy Spirit, the work of Christ, and the will of the Father that lead people to saving grace. Paul teaches us here an important reminder. It's not our convincing language or articulation of the truth that saves people. It isn't our ability to present the gospel in a cohesive, well-formulated, and eloquent manner. Rather, it is the power of God that saves people through our willingness to share it and display it. This brings us to our final characteristic of Paul that can encourage us here. Paul's trust in God. Paul recognized that the potential faith of those who heard him share the gospel needed to rest in the power of God and not in the wisdom of men. So now, let's read about Saul when he was Paul. Because remember, before Saul was Paul, Paul was Saul. And Saul, well, yeah, never mind. Let Acts tell us what happened. So if you turn with me to Acts chapter 9, we're going to unpack Paul's conversion story just a little bit here this morning. So Acts chapter 9, starting in verse 3. Now as he, Saul, went on his way, he approached Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven shone around him. And falling to the ground, he heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" He said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." I want you to leave your Bibles open to that passage. This is the very moment that Paul recognizes the life-changing power of Christ. From that moment on, Paul's life would never be the same. Paul had experienced the power of God. But please take note of something else in this passage. Look at how closely Jesus identifies with those that trust and follow in him. Jesus says here that to persecute his disciples was to persecute him. Jesus is with them in their suffering. Remember the Great Commission, that Jesus would be with us? See how it's sort of all coming together? Let's keep reading in Acts chapter 9. Let's jump to verse 10. Now there was a disciple at Damascus named Ananias. Can we say Ananias? Ananias. And he said, "Here I am, Lord." And the Lord said to him, "Rise and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas look for a man of Tarsus named Saul, for behold, he is praying. And he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay hands on him so that he might regain his sight. But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints at Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who call on your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine, to carry my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." Paul experienced the power of God in an amazing way. Jesus himself showed up on the road to meet Saul, and from that moment on, his life would never be the same. Paul had experienced the power of God. And the same way that Jesus is with those disciples whom Paul persecuted, so too would Jesus be with Paul in what would be his suffering for the gospel. The thorn in his side. In his weakness, in his fear, in his trembling, Paul trusted Jesus. And And now, as Paul writes this letter to the Corinthian church, he wants them to remember that true faith in Christ requires one to trust in the power of God, not the wisdom of men. Because there is a risk, friends. If Paul evangelized using purely rhetorical techniques and wordplay, they may have embraced Christ because of those particular techniques, convincing speech, not because of the wonder of the cross itself. The substance of one's preaching and one's evangelism and one's witness to the world is to be the gospel of Christ. Everything should point back to that, back to the cross, back to the resurrection, back to his saving grace. Like Paul, we all here in this room have a story. We all have that moment, that conversion moment that we recognize the power of God in our lives. We all have that time that we look back and we recognize when we truly tasted that grace. And God uses our stories to witness to the world. But it's not just our story that saves people. It's the power of God. Jesus saves people, like you and like me. Through his life, death, and resurrection and the power of his word, he speaks grace and truth to the world and offers new life to those who choose to put their faith in him. Paul's faith rested in that truth because he experienced that truth for himself. Jesus showed up when he least expected it, and his life was changed forever. And his life and ministry has echoed through generation after generation through the power of the Holy Spirit in letters like this one that we are reading this morning. This is only possible through the power of God. And Paul's faith rested in that power because Paul had experienced the power of God. Do we trust in the power of God in our world today? Do we trust that the same God that displayed his power to the Corinthians in Scripture is the same God that moves in our communities today as well? That he moves in your families, in your friendships, in your workplaces, that he works in your weaknesses, in your fears, and your hardships? I promise you, he does and he is. Right now, where you are, what you're experiencing, God has a plan and a purpose for you. And he will provide a way to walk that path that is laid out before you. So, what can we learn from the Apostle Paul this morning? Well, I'd like to offer three different ways that we can learn to trust in the power of God. And we'll break them down in three ways. The first one is we can trust in God's plan. Second, we can trust in God's providence. And third, we can trust in God's promise. God has a plan for you. He has called you into his kingdom out of his abundance of grace. You are part of God's plan. Your story is part of God's plan. In fact, God created you and your plan. He knitted it all together, and he is with you every step of the way. Brenna and I, my wife, we have selected life verses for our children. These are verses that we pray over our kids every day and recite together with them before bed. And Porter, our second and loudest, child of three, he's funny. His life verse that we've selected for him comes from Deuteronomy 31, verse 6. And that passage says this: be strong and courageous. Do not fear or be in dread of them, for it is the Lord your God who goes with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. I can still hear his little voice in my head as I say that. In this passage, God is speaking to Israel through Moses. Moses, in what their future is going to look like as they finally enter the promised land after decades of journeying through the wilderness. They are about to make their way into the promised land, and there will be foes, there will be adversaries. And really, the entire book of Deuteronomy is a reminder, a recalling of God's faithfulness to his people. And at the end of the book, Moses now shifts his focus and attention to what will come. To remember what God has done and trust in what God will do. And then we see that word for again. For. Remember back to what for means. Do not fear or be in dread of them. For the Lord of God, the Lord your God goes with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. God is with us, friends, now more than ever. He is closer to us now than he has ever been throughout history. For God, through the power of his Spirit, now lives in us. And God has brought you to where you are in your life right now, in this moment, for a purpose. He has a plan for the circumstances that you find yourself in. God's plan for you is not someone else's plan. That's not like get that confused. Now, I won't ask you to put up your hands, but I would hinder a guess, because we as a people are really good at this, that in some way, shape or form, over the past little while, everyone in this room at some point has probably compared themselves to somebody else. Don't do that. Don't ever do that. Don't compare yourself to others. Don't compare the places that God has brought you to the place that God has brought others. Because if you do, you might miss what God is wanting to do through you right now. The world tells us to compare where we are to where others are. Worldly wisdom tells us to try and be better than the next person so you don't get left behind. But your journey is unique in that God has brought you to this moment in your life for a specific purpose. Maybe it's an easy season, maybe it's a difficult one. But regardless, you won't get left behind because God is with you. But whether in hills or valleys, you can trust God's plan for you. And here's a really cool thing. God's plan for you and his workings through you is also part of God's plan for others. Remember when Paul came to Corinth? The Lord spoke to Paul and told him not to fear, for there are many in the city that are his people. This is before the Corinthian church came to know God. God has a plan that is far bigger than you or I, and he desires to use our lives as a way by which others can recognize his grace and truth. But don't look too far ahead. Don't get caught up in the what if, but focus on the what is. Look to what is immediately around you, the people around you, the opportunities around you. Trust that God's power will be displayed through you in unique ways. The second way I want to encourage you to trust in the power of God is by trusting in God's providence. Now, God's providence is essentially God's intervention in the world. God, through his perfect wisdom and love, cares and directs all things in the universe. Friends, we serve a sovereign God. We serve a God that is in control. We serve a God that is surprised by nothing because he directs and purposes all things. Psalm 103, verse 19 says, "The Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all." Do we trust that God's kingdom rules over all, that God is in control? Think with me for a moment, just for a moment, about redemptive history. God created the world and gave Adam and Eve free will. And within the first three chapters of Scripture, sin enters the equation, and Adam and Eve were separated from God, completely and utterly bound by sin. And the rest of this story, this amazing story, is God working in us and through us on our behalf to bring about the Messiah, to redeem us, and to give us hope and a future, to reconcile us to himself, to bring us out of slavery, of sin, and into the freedom of Christ. Do we really think that if God wasn't in control, that any of this would have happened? Seriously, in the first three chapters, we messed everything up, and God spent the other 1,186 chapters moving through history to provide salvation and reconciliation to us. If the God of the universe did this for you and did this for me, let's not be mistaken in thinking that God isn't active in our lives right now and will continue to be throughout all of our days. If stepping into God's plan seems difficult, that is okay. You can trust that God will provide a way. If God has a plan for you, which we've established that he does, then God has a way by which he is going to accomplish his plan. It's not unknown to him, even though it might be unknown to us. And that can be challenging. But in these seasons, friends, that you can't see a way by which God's plan and purpose is going to unpack in your life, dig deeper. Be in his word. Ask him the tough questions. Seek the difficult answers. Whatever you do, just don't be silent on the issue. Maybe be silent in your speech and be open in your hearing and listening. Keep moving forward in the direction that God has called you towards, because God has given you a plan and a purpose. Take that next step. Continue down the path that's laid out before you. God carved out a path through history to redeem his people. We can trust that he will continue to carve out a path for you in your life to fulfill the purposes that he has called, that he has for you and his kingdom. And finally, we can learn to trust in God's power by trusting in God's promise. Jesus says in John chapter 11, right before he raises Lazarus from the dead, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet he shall live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." Do you believe this? God has purposed creation, history, redemption, and future reconciliation of all things for his glory. He has done all this because of his love, mercy, and grace for us. Do you believe this? It's the fulfillment of a promise that he accomplished in the person and work of Jesus, who came into this world as a servant, died the death on the cross that we deserved, was resurrected into new life, and ascended to heaven as king, and his kingdom now reigns in heaven. And he will one day return and bring us with him to glory. Do you believe this? Jesus, who now continues to reign, interceding for us and working through us in the power of the Holy Spirit, who promises to be with us today and all days until he returns to take us home. This is God's promise towards us. This is the power of God at work in the world. Do you believe this? Friends, do not trust in your own ability. Don't trust in your own ability to share the power of God, for God displays his power just fine. But point to it. Live it out in your life. Speak to those around you. Let the power of God work in you and through you the same way that it did to Paul. I'd like to invite the music team to come up here just in closing. And as we close, I'd like to read for you an excerpt from one of my favorite chapters in all of Scripture, which is Romans chapter 8. This is a chapter of Scripture that has really been with me since I came to know the Lord, and I just want to share a little bit of that with you this morning. So Romans chapter 8. We're going to be looking at verses 31 to 39. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake, we are being killed all the day long. Guarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No. Say it with me. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure. I am sure. step, nor anything else in all creation, will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing, friends, can separate us from that love. Thank you, God.
It's good to be together, to learn together, and a great reminder from God's Word about His power in us. Maybe as we sing this song, as you listen to this message, there are pieces that you have, that you hold, and you wonder, how will God bring this together? And you know, as you look at the life of Paul, as Pat has reminded us, he had this promise that God would be with him. But you read his life, he suffered. He was arrested in prison. He was beaten. He was left for dead. He went through a lot of hard times. Yet he also had this promise. And we'll close with this benediction. And may it be yours. And so maybe there's pieces that you need to hold out to God and to ask him to bring victory where all you see is loss. Bring healing where you see suffering. Thanks be to God that he gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know, that your labor in the Lord will not be in vain. All God's people said, amen. God be with you.